Hey guys, Grace and I are back for episode. I think we're on 8 now. I don't know. I can't count. Anyway, we decided to be on just the two of us because we realized we have not done a solo episode since we started. But we asked you guys for some suggestions and we're making our way through them. And the first one we wanted to talk about was our aunts, and they have the same name, Flo. So yeah, guys, this is a more gender-specific episode, but doesn't mean you can't learn a few things, right? So, all right, we're going to tell you guys, starting off, what catamenial epilepsy is, because a lot of people may have it and don't know it. So, by definition, blank.
So, catamenial epilepsy is a gender-specific type of epilepsy in which seizure frequency intensifies during certain phases of the menstrual cycle. And this is all from the Epilepsy Foundation's website. It has been noted since ancient times as well.
Yeah, and I did not know until we just ran over that it's been around since that long. So that kind of makes sense for the whole Salem witch trials and all that fun stuff, right? Yeah, so kind of makes sense.
Yep, studies suggest that catamenial epilepsy is seen in 10 to 70% of women with epilepsy. That is
it's very, very common.
It can be, yeah.
Yeah, it can be very common. Wow. Yeah, I am one of the lucky 10 to, that's a big margin. That's weird.
It is. It's very 10 to 70%. So either no chance or a lot of chance.
It's almost like 0 to 100%. Like, okay. But I know that changes with, epilepsies and syndromes and stuff like that. That's probably why. But I have it. It's fun, except for not at all. So
I have it, but have not been formally diagnosed. It's not listed in my diagnoses, but it has been noted by my doctors that there is a big relationship between both seizures and migraines, like with my menstrual cycle. So I have been prescribed birth control and I take it continuously to keep from getting my periods, and it has helped a lot.
And I don't take birth control anymore, and mine is actually under my entire epilepsy folder of having catamenial epilepsy as one of my types. But it was almost surefire every single month I would get at least one seizure, if not clusters, if not them, for like the week before, week after. Like it was bad.
I'd have a seizure and then the next day I'd be like, oh, it makes sense.
Yeah.
Like, pretty much like, at that point.
I didn't know that there was a connection until like I started talking to my doctor and he was like, well, what are you doing? Are you emotional? You know, stuff. And I was like, well, yeah, I'm kind of emotional because I'm on my period. And that's when he was like, does it happen all the time on your period? And I was like, yeah, it does. And that's when he had me chart it. I don't know if your doctor has had you do that yet, but
I keep a log of, I had like a period tracking app and I would kind of take notes on my seizures in that app as well. So I could see like ovulating on my period, like both of those weeks would be just full of seizures until I finally found, I spent a year and a half trying to find birth control that worked for me. And then I finally did, it was like, thank God. It took, and changing doctors was a big one for my gynecologist, because the first one I saw like was just rude and didn't really listen to me. And, you know, I was like, I'm just here because my neurologist suggested it to stop my seizures. And at one point she called me and she was like, does your neurologist know that you're on this? I'm like, yes, I told you he suggested it. Like,
me? It's like, doesn't she have to get the referral from your neurologist?
She didn't. They were at two different hospitals at that
point. Okay, I was like, huh?
I just went and talked with her.
Okay. Some doctors are just
I ended weird. Up switching gynecologists after that because I was like, I had other issues going on too. And I was like, she's not the person that I want to be dealing with.
But it's like, you're around butts too much. You're becoming one. Like, stop.
The one that I have now is at the same hospital as the rest of them. So like all of my notes are also all connected, which is super nice because they can look through everything and be like, okay, makes sense.
Mine was my younger doctor that first diagnosed it when I was at UCLA. He was like the one that like caught everything. He was just like on a roll. It seems like I don't know what happened. Sad I don't have him anymore. But he had me go on the depot shot, and it worked almost instantaneously. It took, you know, it got rid of my cycle, which is always lovely, but and my seizure stopped. But it made me go from like a size 8 to like a size 16. So I stopped taking it, and it had me grow like funny hair like on my face, and I still get to deal with that, which is awesome. I just, you know, get rid of it. But so I was like, you know what, before I have more facial hair than my boyfriend, I think I'm gonna stop. You know, like
maybe I should talk about stopping this.
Yeah, and once I stopped, like, I'm still working on losing the weight, because it's not normal weight gain, if that makes sense. It's a whole special, it's hormonal weight gain and water weight, so it just sits there. It's like I'm still working on getting it off, and I haven't been on it since last July, but I haven't had seizures really since then, since I got off of it. And it was just like I took it every 3 months. I don't know how often you take it, but I just got a shot in the butt cheek.
I take the pill, so I take it every day.
Is yours depo, or is yours something different?
It is loloestrin.
Okay, because I didn't. Everyone tells me they're on the depo shot. I'm not saying you're on the wrong thing, but I don't know of any other options. So they asked me. Like,
yeah,
what
I'm
else
on.
There is. I'm like, oh.
I'm on birth control. I just take, or the pill. I just take it continuously, so I skip the placebo week.
Oh, okay. That makes sense. And then there's whatchamacallit. I know there are a few other whatchamacallit prescriptions, whatever, birth controls that hormones in it.
Well, I was going to say, the thing with catamenial epilepsy that you want to talk to your doctor about, if anyone's interested, would be the hormone aspect of it. Because there are lots that you can try that don't have hormones, but if your goal is to stop the hormone, I mean, and there's no way you can 100% stop hormones, they're still going to fluctuate a little bit. Like, my doctor has said, you know, I still get the little fluctuations, but it's nothing compared to what it was. But definitely talk to your doctor about a hormone style one that you can use, because ones that don't have hormones may not necessarily affect your cycle, if that makes sense.
Yeah, and it may, yeah, exactly. And my doctor put me on folic acid to combat that as well, because the anti-seizure meds tend to, like, I don't want to say lessen, but I guess we could say affect your eggs and your reproductive system and your ovaries.
Yep,
and
my
stuff.
Doctor has me on folic acid as well.
Yeah,
and she said she recommends it for, you know, women. She said any of her patients who are women of childbearing age.
That's what my doctor told me too. He said, you're of childbearing age. He's like, even if you don't want kids, he's like, you should take this for your hormones. And I'm like, oh, okay. So.
And that, I just recently started taking it. Oops. it's
don't listen,
when,
doctor.
When you can't go to the pharmacy yourself and you have to rely on other people, because my mom, bless her heart, bought cherry chews. I was like, this tastes like the medicine from when I was 5. Like, I need a pill, please. Yeah. So it took a while, but I finally got it, and I'm taking it every day now, along with vitamin D.
I take vitamin B6 and B12 and fiber. But, again, everyone's meds are different, so don't just start, you know, don't go to GNC.
Yeah. I definitely
buy everything.
Discuss any supplements that you should be taking with your doctor.
I even asked if she would be okay. Well, it's a she. Yes, it's a she now. That was a weird switch without mentioning that. You have a new doctor now. She was even kind of like, I don't want you to take any of like the brain like fog meds. Like, I want you to do it more like as naturally as possible. So she's not giant on loading me up with, like, you know, a vitamin shop. So
yeah, I mean, which can be nice, because we already have to take so many meds if we can.
And that's
keep
exactly
it,
what she said. Yeah,
if we can keep it more natural,
that's what she said. And she said a lot of them, she's like, even if you do take them, the med will kind of counteract that anyway. So it's kind of, you're taking it like as like a placebo, you know what I mean? Like it doesn't, you'd have to take like, you know, I'm not talking about protein in general, but if it's protein, it's like, you'd have to eat like an entire steak to combat the amount of seizure meds depending on, you know, it's like, geez, it's not worth it. It wipes me out. I know I'm moodier on my period than I was before I had epilepsy, that's for sure.
I think epilepsy just makes you moody in general.
I think it does too, but that week,
I think it's because we're tired all the time. It just comes out in like weird moods.
Like, yeah, especially around that time of the month, I'll just start crying for no reason. And then like once I get it out, I'm like, cool, I'm done, I'm good.
I just do that. It's not even like a certain time every month. I just do that. I call it my monthly I can't drive breakdown. And it usually happens when there's some, it hasn't happened, you know, since everything, because we can't go anywhere. But before that, it was like once a month, there would be something that I really want to do and I couldn't get to where I wanted to go. And I would just cry for like 5 minutes and then I'd be like, okay.
That is like a couple days ago. I had like a mini meltdown over like basically not being able to be in control of anything because everyone's there for every decision I made. And then like, I got over it. I'm like, whatever. It happens. Being a woman with epilepsy is fun because we're already an emotional species. So, you know. My gosh, I don't know what else my doctor, I'm trying to think of anything else. There isn't a test that can necessarily determine that you have catamenial epilepsy.
Yep, this
you have to chart.
The Epilepsy Foundation says it is identified by charting seizures and menses in a diary.
Okay, yep,
so that's for at exactly least two what I menstrual to cycles, you need to have two menstrual cycles where there is an occurrence of more seizure activity for them to consider it catamenial.
Yes, and unfortunately, or not fortunately, unfortunately, but guys, this has nothing to do with you guys. So, yeah, you guys are lucky on this one. I know there's male-specific epilepsies, but, like, this one has nothing to do with you guys.
I cannot speak for the male-specific epilepsies.
No, I don't know about them, but I remember looking them up. There were some that were very, like, prevalent and prominent in men, but this is not one of them. Also my doctors, I asked about, because I've said multiple times I'm probably not gonna have children with, you know, the severity of my epilepsy and my brain surgeries and stuff, but I asked my doctor like if a hysterectomy in the future would be a good idea, and she said absolutely not, because
it will changes throw your you hormones so much. Yep,
early menopause. Yeah, and she said absolutely not, that'll make it worse for you. And so also I'm assuming menopause will be a whole nother round of catamenial epilepsy, whole different chapter. Yeah. I'm wondering, and I've seen a couple of people go through menopause and it's already lovely and friendly. Let's put it that way.
Yep. So the Epilepsy Foundation also says that traditionally not anti-epileptic drugs, or now, in case you didn't see our post, they are now called anti-seizure medications because they treat the seizures, not the epilepsy. There's no treatment for epilepsy at the moment, or no cure. They target only the seizures, which makes more sense because they're also working on drugs to specifically target epilepsy itself.
And that's why we have to take mood stabilizers and this and this and this, because they don't have something that'll treat it all.
So traditionally, anti-seizure medications do not have an effect on seizures and catamenial epilepsy because they are affected by the menstrual cycle, which makes sense why I wasn't having too many seizures until, you know, those times. Mm-hmm. And then my body was like, hey. So birth control, in a sense, has become another seizure medication, if you want to.
I guess so, yeah. If it's hormone based, I guess so, yeah. Because it regulates your hormones. So I guess that would be like also like how our mental health meds help the stress, anxiety, blah blah blah. It's, and a lot of them do doubles anti seizure meds. Funny enough, because it numbs your brain. But I guess technically so, because if we're gonna throw marijuana in the mix, you know, Why not, you know, or keto in the mix, that alters your chemistry of your brain. So I guess it's technically the same thing.
Yeah,
and I know it's not cheap.
So 10 to 70% of women could have it, right? We said that was like this giant gap. And it says approximately half the women of childbearing age who have epilepsy report an increase in seizures around the time of their monthly menstrual period.
So there's 10 to 70% of women that have it, and then a specific age group, it increases by
50%. So half the women of childbearing age, yep. And studies show that changes in seizures are most often in the middle of the cycle around ovulation and about a week before your period.
Yep. I had that. That was actually the cause of the seizure, I believe, in on the cruise I had, because it was, I started my period like 2 days later. So I was like, well,
and this again, I would say only talk to your doctor before doing, but my doctor has also suggested, if for some reason I, you know, I skip the placebo week, but I still get my period, which has happened a couple times, to slightly increase my one seizure med just for the time that I'm on my period. And that has helped as well. Again, definitely talk to your doctor before making any changes to your medication. But that is something that she recommended in case I do have breakthrough bleeding.
I'm trying to think of what mine's, just mine was the depo shot. I got it every 3 months, and I got mine late once or twice and it was bad. So make sure you get it when you're supposed to get it on your regular thing. And I know, I think there are variants of it, but a lot of people have told me that that stuff makes you gain weight. So be careful, be mindful of that, because yeah, it happens. It's very, very common to gain weight. So it's not, it's not something to mess around with, because then that adds to a whole, you know, different bout of problems and mental health.
But again, it's something, you know, talk to your doctor if you're having issues. Cause like I said, it took a year and a half for me to find a birth control pill that actually worked for me.
I want to say it took about even 6 to 7 years before they figured out that I had it. So, or, you know, they didn't really catch the pattern.
I was still with my pediatric neurologist when we figured it out. Cause I was, I think 18, so it was about a year after I had been diagnosed with epilepsy that I was like, hey, I've noticed this. And he was like, okay. I was like, what do you think about birth control? And he's like, it's worth talking to someone.
And mine, I didn't, mine were so bad at the time. They were also not just catamenial based. So mine were all over the place.
So were mine.
So I had no idea. I was just like, oh. And then finally they'd slow down and then they'd increase over my cycle. So then I was like, huh, wait a minute. Like, not only do I get the lovely visit of my most favorite aunt in the world, but she comes with seizures in her bag.
Yeah, that was pretty much how it was for me at the time. I was still having pretty many seizures. But I would still notice that increase like halfway through my cycle. And then when I was on my period and I was like, okay. And I started noting that. And I was like, hooray. We love this. We love this for me.
But that's another reason. Like, I know it's a pain to journal. I have I have an app on my phone. I have notes in my phone and I have 3 notebooks that I just wish when I find, I write stuff down in, because that way I can write it down. But this is why it's important to keep notes.
Yeah, they unfortunately got rid of the one app that I was using to track everything. I was so sad.
Man.
I got a new phone and they were like, this app is no longer available. And I looked it up. So many people were using it to track medical stuff and just lost everything. Which
I use
sucks.
My seizure diary. It's an app on iPhone. I don't think it's on Android, but that's what I use. And you can put you can connect it with your doctor, and your doctor will more than likely have your seizure types written down. And if you know what type it was, you can select it, or you can select unknown. You can put the time, or you can put unknown. You put the trigger, or put unknown, you know, type of thing. And then underneath, there's like a little box where you can like describe whatever. And if you don't have a seizure, you can put no seizure today. And that way your doctor will see a pattern.
Yeah, that's really nice. I just use the notes on my phone now. I've made two, like, because my doctor has said since my most recent EMU stay not to worry about ones where I'm not losing awareness. She's not too worried about those, but I still want to track them. So I've started one note for seizures and migraines and one note for simple, simple partials or focal aware seizures so that I still have both and I can still talk about both. I just don't.
I even have started putting, like, because I don't necessarily use, like, a cycle tracker, but, like, once my period does start, I'll put in my notes, like, day of period.
Starting, I'll put that too.
Or something about, like, even if I miss my meds that day or if I'm having a bad moody day, like, anything you put down can help. It'll help, like, communicate, diagnose, treat, like, so much stuff. It'll help. That was the only way, literally the only way you can catch it if you've noticed a pattern of seizures around this time of the month.
Like you said, there's really no test for catamenial epilepsy. It's more so just noticing the patterns and talking about it with your doctor.
You might get lucky. You might be on your period in the hospital during an EEG stay or an EMU stay, excuse me. But even still, you'll probably need to they'll send you home with a diary and say, keep track of it and let us know in a month, pretty much.
Yeah.
So it's not an overnight diagnosis. And I know people want a snapped finger and a diagnosis, but it takes time. It takes tests. It takes patience. And
all of us with epilepsy know that it's not one simple. I mean, I was pretty much diagnosed, you have epilepsy, but I didn't know the type that I had. I didn't know why I had it for at least another year after my diagnosis, or I knew the type a couple months after because I was able to get into the EMU, but it took months and a week of an EMU stay and multiple MRIs, and it wasn't a quick, hey, you have this, why, like with one test. It was multiple tests, and I know for you it took like 10 years.
I just got my official, and I mean, it might change over the course of my life.
Yeah, like, your seizure types can change while you're having seizures, could potentially change.
Do new automatisms, do new things, new triggers can pop up, but it's like, they just found out last June, the beginning of June, what all mine were. They defined them all thus far, so they think. And, It was a long 10, 11 years, but it's like, I'm not going to scream at my doctor because, you know, I'd rather, you know, keep going and be like, okay, well, what's next? What can we do next? You know, like, so, and it took a long time, and yeah, there's tough days. Yeah, I understand you want answers quicker, but I mean, like, I think Grace and I have mentioned, this has been around since ancient times, and we're still at the camp at the base of the mountain. So
still got a lot of climbing to do.
Yeah, we're starting to, I think we're slowly starting to pack up camp and head up the mountain, but hopefully, you know, so there are tons of epilepsies, and just because you don't have catamenial epilepsy today doesn't mean you can't have it in the future, blah, blah, blah. Doesn't mean it can't stop. I haven't had a seizure around that time of the month in like over a year. So
same.
You know, changes, but it is something. And I know I have had a lot of people message me and say, whoa, they've defined that. I've noticed that pattern. So here is the name of the pattern that you can present to your doctors to help you try to find it. And it's a weird, odd name, catamenial. I don't know what the heck they were going for on that one, to be honest. But I mean, that's what it is. It's only in women, only in those that are ovulating and having their cycles. So, and
yeah, you know, I did not notice it. Well, to be fair, I wasn't diagnosed before starting my period, but so I guess I can't really say that I didn't notice anything. But you know, young girls probably will not have any changes.
It's a lot. I mean, I started my cycle when I was 11. I was a super lucky child, but I didn't have seizures during that time then. So as my hormones changed and got more into the later stages of life and like having kids and stuff, it got way more severe. So
yep,
that's something to notice too. And I can't speak on behalf of menopause. I'm a while away from that one, so I don't know. But
I do know I know someone who had terrible, terrible migraines, especially associated with her period.
Mm-hmm.
And there was, when she started menopause, her migraines went away. She hasn't had one since she started menopause.
Interesting. See, there's another hormone switch that we'll probably have to look out for in a bit. I mean, but that's like decades away, so I'm not really worried about it. And who knows what will advance by then. So, you know, I'm not worried about it. But it is treatable. It is not curable. Let's say that. Birth control does not cure it, but it can stop it.
Yep.
But be mindful, like I said, of the side effects that come with it. And there are multiple types you can switch. Took her, a year is what you said?
Mm-hmm.
To find your birth control? A year.
Year and a half, yep. I was spotting for a year and a half straight before they figured. So I was having constant seizures for a year and a half.
Yeah, mine, it was just the first one that they tried because it matched up with my meds. And keep that in mind, your birth control will probably be different than everybody else's because of the meds you're taking and the seizures you also have.
Yeah, and again, be afraid to ask your doctor because my sister was on a certain type. My other friends were on that same type. And I said, you know, I messaged her and I was like, can I try this one? It's working for people that I know. These other ones haven't been working for me. They've been making it worse. And this doctor had like attitude. She was like, fine. And that's the one that worked for me. So again, don't be afraid to go out of your way to your doctors are there to help you. So don't feel bad for asking them questions. If you've heard about something that may help you, of course, don't just do it without talking to them first. But
yeah, you can kill yourself, to be quite honest. If you just go cold turkey or make a rash decision, you can hurt yourself drastically or others. Uneducated rash decision, let's put it that way. And it's doctors are not, you know, yes, there are some corrupt and bad doctors in the world, but for the most part, specialists, they're not in to look into your brain to make money. They're there to help you and fix it. So and if you don't like your doctor, get a new one. You'll live in the United States. I know not everybody does, but for those that live in the United States, shush and go get a new doctor.
Or talk more, like talk to the one you have asked questions. Yeah, you can't just sit there and expect. I'm not suggesting anyone does this, but I'm just saying you can't just sit there and magically expect them to figure everything out for you.
Right. They're with you. Say I go every 3 months for maybe 20 minutes an appointment. So, I don't know, that's 80 minutes a year if I don't stay in the EMU. The 80 minutes a year. She has no clue what else I do every single day.
Yep,
you know what I mean?
Twice a year for 30 minutes. So that's a total of an hour a year that she talks with me. You know, a lot of hospitals use ways you can message your doctor to ask questions.
My chart is very common. I have that.
There's my chart. There are a couple others.
Mm-hmm. Certain places have their own, platforms and stuff to communicate. But like everything's online. They probably have an assistant or a nurse or somebody if they're busy. Like you can.
I was gonna say, and you know, if you're noticing a pattern, but let's say you have 3 months until you see your doctor again, message them. Call their office if they don't necessarily use online messaging to let them know what's going on, because that way they can have that plan to discuss at your next appointment or can look into getting you set up with something to help you.
Mm-hmm. And like, I don't want to say I hound my doctor, but pretty close. Like I tell her everything, or at least tell her assistant, and then it gets relayed to her. I tell her, I'm like, oh, or if, you know, I'm like, oh, I missed my meds. I'll keep that in my little seizure log and type of thing. Or like, if I'm out of meds, like I call her right away. That's what her job is. I know you feel awkward sometimes. Probably I do too, but you know, that's what they're there for. So They are humans. They can have conversations. I promise. Oh my gosh. I think that's all I have on my end.
That's all I have to add.
On my end, I mean, I will, if whoever watches this, I will gladly share more in-depth experiences with you about, you know, the catamenial epilepsy if you want, but that's like 10 years of story, so I don't think we need to get into that.
Yeah, just but, again, ask your doctor, yeah. Communicate with your doctor, but make sure before making any decisions that you talk about it with your doctor.
Mm-hmm. And again, the best way to catch this specific type or really any patterns in your epilepsy is to write it down and keep a log.
Yep.
Because I didn't do it until like a couple years ago, and oh man, do I regret it. Like, I'm like, wow, I could have cut things off, the tests and stuff off. You know what I mean? I guarantee it. So now I know. Now I am neurotic about writing it down. So... it helps, but I think next week we're going to cover another topic, or at least soon, so thank you for the suggestions. I know this is probably not on a guy's interest level, but if you're listening, we appreciate it. I think that's all we have for this one. Do you have anything else to add, Grace?
Not that I can think of, no.
All right, well, if you have any questions or suggestions about need any suggestions about us, just let us know. You know, like, we don't mind talking about it, as you can tell. Yeah, I'm not shy when it comes to this stuff. It happens. Alrighty, so thank you guys for the suggestion again on this one, and we will see you on our next episode. Bye.
Bye.